What a dog, what a dog. She's not a tramp, but she sings a swinging jazzy tribute to one. Peg is sultry, smooth, and has obviously had her heart broken one too many times. Who brought motion to this veteran lover? Let's find out. Before we start, don't forget to check out our Discord, our Patreon, and like, subscribe, comment, hit the bell, all the things. It really helps us out. Eric Larson was born in Cleveland, Utah in 1905. Cleveland, Utah? There's a Cleveland in Utah now? What's next, a Paris, Texas? After a short career as a journalist, he was convinced to join Disney, where he worked on the many animals in Snow White, Figaro in Pinocchio, Brutus in Fantasia, Friend Owl in Bambi, and the title character in Cinderella, whose name escapes me at the moment.
I hear you. Come on, get up, you say. Time to start another day. Even he orders me around.
For Disney's Alice in Wonderland, Eric was cast as the stubborn and rude Caterpillar.
Well, the Caterpillar was a person who just was suspicious of almost everyone and everything. And he had to have a word from Alice as to exactly who she was.
Who are you?
Well, I hardly know, sir. I've changed so many times since this morning, you see.
I do not see you.
Well, I can't put it any more clearly, for it isn't clear to me.
You? Who are you?
Eric struggled to make the angry caterpillar look appealing, cartoony, and broad to match other characters in the film. However, many other animators on the film struggled with his cartoony goal, and Eric eventually succeeded with his caterpillar assignment. And just look at this goofy guy.
It goes. Hell.
Eric also animated some of Alice, particularly while she's singing in A World of My Own. Larson's Alice isn't as tied down as Mark and Milt's were, but she is very subtle and has sincerity in her performance. In opposition to Alice, Eric also animated scenes with the Queen of Hearts, where she is yelling and demanding to know who painted the roses red. And just look at this goofy gal.
Who's been painting my roses red? Who dares to taint with vulgar paint the royal flower bed? Painting my roses red. Someone will lose his head.
On Peter Pan, the animator had a very challenging assignment. He had to animate the sequence where Peter and the kids fly into Neverland. And boy, were his arms tired. No, but seriously, it was hard to draw. Eric explains, we not only used multiplane, but we also had to work the hell out of that camera per field. And in-and-out exaggerations, going away from you and coming at you. Besides drawing that, we put emphasis on it by using camera tilts. It was a very beautifully worked-out thing mechanically. It really has a certain thrill to it. Up next for the animator was a really juicy assignment that he thoroughly enjoyed. The reason you're all here, this was, of course, Peg from Lady and the Tramp.
What a dog.
Larson did a brilliant job at using touches in the way she walks and moves to enrich that personality, and the acting is top-notch.
She wrote the song, she sang it, and the way she sang it was a great inspiration, but also another great inspiration was the way she walked, because she had pretty nice movement. And these are things that you try to pick up from the human being and translate into the animal.
You can never tell when he'll show up. He gives you plenty of trouble. I guess he's just a no-count pup. But I wish that he were double. He's a tramp. He's a rover. And there's nothing more to say. If he's a tramp, he's a good one, and I wish that I could travel his way. Wish that I could travel his way. Wish that I could travel his way.
The tone of the walk and the spacing between Peg's steps were enough to tell the audience she's a seductive, free spirit. Or, in layman's terms, va-va-voom! Oh-oh! Bernie Mattinson remembers, it was interesting because here was Eric, who's a Mormon, and he's animating this sexy girl and having the best time. Unfortunately, Eric's next project proved to be a very negative experience for him and turned his career in a direction he was never able to overcome. So get ready for the drama. Sleeping Beauty had begun story work in 1951, and voices were recorded soon after. But in December 1953, Wilfred Jackson, who up to that point was directing the project, had a heart attack and had to step down. Eric was chosen to take up the mantle of director for the entire film. However, the production proved to be extremely difficult, and things moved extremely slowly. Eric got his first sequence to work on in Sleeping Beauty and had very little help, remembers Bernie Mattinson, who would later assist Larson for a dozen years. Even his longtime assistant George Gepper was modeling things for Disneyland, so everything moved very, very slowly. Eric was also one of those very precise people, so when he handed out sweatbox notes, he told you exactly how to correct the situation. The notes were very long and detailed. I think management looked at those notes and thought, this guy's making too much work for these people. It was wrong that he got a lot of blame for it. Although he was good at paying attention to detail and was always very patient, he ultimately didn't have the leadership to put everything together and keep the production moving. Larson struggled with being a hammer and didn't do much to prevent tensions and problems on the production, such as Avon Earl's over-dominance of the film. He also got a lot of blame for the large budget of the film. Sadly, in 1958, Eric was removed as director of Sleeping Beauty, and Wolfgang Reitherman and Jerry Geronimi finished the picture. On Disney's next film, 101 Dalmatians, Eric got the opportunity to be a directing animator one more time, where he animated a lot of the puppies. Larson's most notable scene in the film is the one where all the Dalmatians are watching TV. You know, probably the most adorable scene in Disney history. Ooh, that reminds me, right about now I could go for some canine crunchies. I'm hungry. I really am.
I'm so hungry I could eat a whole elephant.
Whatever those puppies did, it was something that someone in the audience's kids had done at one time. They wanted to see television, or they were hungry, they wanted something to eat. Their emotional things, their emotional attitudes were the attitudes of youngsters. Get down, you're blocking the view of the television set, you know, I can't see.
Lucky, get down.
With the parents, again, you were trying to reflect back at the way your parents treated you. Pongo had no qualms about allowing one of the puppies to sit on his head and while they were watching television. And now it was about time to go to bed, and mother would take over and say, tell them it was time to go to bed. And you treated these pups just as if, well, they were youngsters in a household.
Ready? We'd better get these little nippers off to bed if we're going for a W-A-L-K.
We want to go too, Mother.
Can we, Mother, can we?
We never get to go.
Go along, children. Bedtime.
But we're not a bit sleepy.
Unfortunately, things were getting a lot more cliché at Disney, and with Wolfgang Reitherman as the director of the films, it was quite easy for an unselfish, laid-back animator like Eric to go underappreciated and pushed around. As a result, on Sword in the Stone, he was demoted to character animation and only animated a few bits and pieces on the film. On Mary Poppins, he animated everyone's favorite characters, the farm animals.
The daffodils are smiling at the dove.
The demotion was still held during Jungle Book, but he did get more scenes including Mowgli arguing with Bagheera and a lot of stuff on the vultures.
And the vultures in the Jungle Book, I kind of enjoyed. You know, I hated that assignment when it first came up. And I thought, gosh, what am I going to do with these jerks? But I enjoyed it very much when I finally got onto it. Again, they had to act like birds. There was a minimum amount of gesturing or that kind of thing. You had to get an expression and body attitudes, but they became personalities.
Okay,
So what we're going to do?
I don't know. What do you want to do?
Look, Flaps, first I say what we're going to do. Then you say, I don't know, what do you want to do? Then I say what we're going to do. You say what you want to do. What we're going to do, what you want. Let's do something.
Okay. What do you want to do?
Oh, I think the voices played a big part in that, which quite so often happens, you know. If you get a good voice, well, it's a pretty good springboard.
His vultures show the animator's extensive knowledge of animal anatomy and strength in the fundamentals of timing in animation. Also, they were trying to get the Beatles to voice them. Just a fun little fact for you there. On Aristocats, he continued to be phased out and did some animation of Scat Cat as well as a lot of Roquefort.
Oh, Edgar! I've got to do something quick!
Oh, Edgar, old chap, get used to the finer things of life. Someday they're all going to be yours, you sly old fox.
Oh!
His last feature was Robin Hood, where he animated a few scenes of Little John and was gradually phased out during production. Ice, cold. So, in 1973, Eric put down the pencil and decided to spend all his time on a more important endeavor, his new job as the head of the Disney training program. Many other animators and artists at Disney didn't care too much about the future of Disney animation and were at best passive to the issue that they hadn't done a good job of training new artists and finding a continuous flow of talent to the studio. Yikes. With the Disney films not as high quality as they used to be and artists beginning to get old, retire, and in some cases even die, Eric Larson decided to redirect his career so he could devote full time to training a new generation of artists.
I found that when I got here that you hid nothing. All these people, talented as they were and at the top of the profession at that time, were so anxious to have you know everything that they knew, and they would talk to you about it. You could ask them questions. They would sit down on the board with you and diagram what they were trying to tell you. I felt that this exchange of ideas was the whole thing the studio was being built on.
Eric's training program was essential in setting the foundation for the second generation to shine and found such talents as Ted Kiersey, Dale Baer, John Pomeroy, Ron Clements, Andy Gaskell, Glenn Keane, Ed Gumbert, Randy Cartwright, Dan Hansen, John Musker, Brad Bird, Jerry Reese, Mike Jamo, Chris Buck, Mike Cedino, John Lasseter, Handel Butoy, Andreas Deja, Mark Henn, Barry Temple, Joe Rand, Kathy Zielinski, Dave Pruksma, Ruben Aquino, Ellen Woodbury, and Duncan Majorbanks.
Eric was starting to work on the idea of teaching when I got into when I first started in animation. People realized that, hey, I should go see Eric. And so they'd come into Eric and ask his advice.
You would take your paper and animation and you would give it, you know, you'd show him the scenes and he would put the drawings down on the drawing board and put a piece of paper over that. And then he would, in a simple fashion, draw over your drawings.
Just him doing that, all of a sudden you saw every mistake you made in the thing. And all you wanted to do was grab that film off the moviola and go back to your room and fix it. You know, he didn't have to say a word. I mean, all he had to do was just draw a few little things and you got the idea.
Eric was the person that I first met when I applied for a job here. And Eric, to me, is just the answer to everything. And he can help you with your drawing, or he can help you with why you can't work that day. You have artist block. Eric, I can't draw. I haven't been able to draw for a week. And somehow he has a way of working you out of it. Basically, whenever I need help with anything, I come here.
He always reminds me of just the fundamental things that I tend to forget. You know, it's like animation's so complex and everyone, how many drawings are in there and stuff, but Eric always comes back to, like, what does the audience perceive?
The fact that he stayed here all these, he doesn't need to be here, but it's his love for what the medium can be and, you know, and what he sees in us as people and what he can give us that keeps him around.
But he was like a grandfather to us, you know. I mean, he was the most gentle person.
He would take your animation and in simple fashion show you how to make clearer statements, how to make stronger statements. Somehow everybody thinks, oh, it's all the detail in the drawing in Disney. It's all that detail. And it wasn't really about the detail, it was about the big strokes in a way, it was about the big arcs. There's a beauty to that movement, and there's a way to make your eye, you know, direct your eye to that movement.
Acting is what is basically what the body does. You may think that the frown on a person's face suggests anger. You may think that the wide eyes suggest surprise. No wide eyes, no wide open mouth suggest surprise. Now they do. But we have found, and it was always Walt's contention, that if the body doesn't say it, it isn't being said. All these other things, the facial expressions, are embellishments. There's a thought that goes this way, that no inner experience. There is no inner expression or experience, nothing inside of us that doesn't have an external physical expression. There's one big thing, there's one big question that we keep asking each other, and that is, can we see what we're trying to draw? Can we see this situation? Do we understand it? Can we visualize it up here? Dave Hand, who was one of our early supervising directors, used to say to an animator, when you pick up a scene from a director or a series of scenes, go down to your room and spend half your time thinking about it, working it out in your mind, thumbnailing it, getting it completely organized within your thinking, your thought processes. Then sit down to your drawing board. And invariably we see people who get something from a director and they go downstairs and they immediately use this darn old layout and whatever they have and they start to animate. This is nothing but disaster. You've got to have a visual picture up here. If we can't see it, we can't draw it. And this is something that we've been trying to get our young people to understand, and our older people too, including me.
Eric absolutely loved working with his students and was a wonderful teacher.
Working with the younger animators has been a great lift. It's part of the studio. And to see a new staff developed, and they are developing fast. We've got some wonderful young people coming along. This has to be a source of satisfaction. And there's something about young people that helps to keep you young, or helps to keep me young, even though I don't look it. But the spirit is there.
Unfortunately, the passing of his wife in 1975 and changes happening at the studio started Eric down a path of depression. One incident involved Eric directing and developing a short called The Small One, specifically for his students to work on and learn from. However, as Bernie Mattinson explains, so, we came in on Friday, everything was happy. Monday, everything in our rooms was gone. Everything, every storyboard, every drawing we had on it, the rooms were wiped out. We found out that management had overnight decided to turn over the project to Don Bluth to direct. It was a horrible thing to do. It originated with Eric. It was for Eric's use, and then these guys just moved in. Eric stayed teaching, but things were never the same. Many people blame Bluth taking over the production of The Small One as the event that broke the peace at the Disney studio and began all the politics and battles that would extend well after Don Bluth departed in 1979. Whoever side you were on, the college campus feel to the studio was over. And Eric, who wasn't happy at all with the politics, had to constantly tell people to concentrate on the art. Yeesh. 7 years later, he again had hard feelings towards management when the corporate takeover took place, where he was forced off the Disney lot alongside the rest of the animation staff to a warehouse in Glendale. Moving from a sunny, nice office which he had worked in for 40 years to an enclosed office with no windows, as well as the declining state of the studio, convinced him to retire in 1986 at the age of 80. After, his homesickness for Disney sent him into a deep depression. On October 25th, 1988, Eric Larson passed away at the age of 83. The prince in The Little Mermaid was named Eric in his memory. Eric Larson was a sweet and lovable artist, who will forever be remembered not only for his impressive contributions to Disney animation, but also for his contribution to Disney's future generations. So many artists have him to thank for learning animation, and so many Disney fans have him to thank for amazing moments in Disney films. Talented people, again, such as Ted Kiersey, Dale Baer, John Pomeroy, Ron Clements, Andy Gaskell, Glenn Keane, Ed Gumbert, Randy Cartwright, Dan Hansen. Thank you to these people for supporting us on Patreon. And if you want to make sure this channel sticks around, you can check out the Patreon link in the description. Every bit helps. Thank you for watching this episode of Discographies. Click the thumbs up button below if you liked it. And if you want to be notified when the next episode comes out, consider subscribing and hitting the bell. Comment below with characters you would like to see us cover. Further reading and references are linked below. We hope to see you in another Discography.